Dick Flanders, for those of you who don't know, secretary on the Historical Society's board and on the program committee, along with Judy Floyd. Judy, raise your hand. There's Judy. Betty Batchelor. Come on, Betty. And Linda Barlett. Yay. Other members of the board with us tonight include beloved president, Cassie Hillier. Cassie, back there. Lisa Landeri on the TV. Rondi. Is Rondi here tonight?
No.
Rondi Gant couldn't make it, okay. Paul Floyd is here.
She intends to be.
She does?
She's on our way home from Keene.
Let's hope she makes it. And Winnie, did Winnie make it? Yes, Winnie, thank you. Winnie Estecki. Louise McCormick was also unable to attend tonight. This program is the second of our series in 2017. And we're trying to offer them monthly and hopefully on topics of local interest. I'd like to take the opportunity to mention that we will be updating our museum display to focus on the role of agriculture. So instead of seeing the Fausties and whatever focused in the back, we're going to try to put together a display of agricultural interest. And consistent with that theme, in 5 weeks, Wednesday, April 26th at 7 p.m., we are excited to have with us our first Humanities-sponsored Speaker of the Year. And over the years, he retired as New Hampshire's Commissioner of Agriculture, Steve Taylor, is going to share with us an interesting talk. And he's done a number of these. I've been to several myself. He's talked about issues dealing with New Hampshire's agricultural affairs, the sheep boom in Boston. I don't know if you've seen that one. He did one on cows or something once, I remember. Anyway, the upcoming presentation is on the topic of poorhouses in town farms, the hard row for paupers. So that should be a good talk here in 5 weeks. Yeah. Then on July 12th, we have our second New Hampshire Humanities sponsored speaker. I've been able to wrestle Tom Hupka, who lives in Oregon and is here seasonally. He's going to give a presentation on his research in his book, Big House, Little House, Back House, Farm, the Connected Farm Buildings of New England. I happen to bring my copy about halfway through it. It's a fascinating book of research on farm structures in the 1800s. In addition, the program folks have David Sakura as an invited speaker on May 17th to talk about Japanese encampments, and Roger and Eva Ellsworth will come on June 21st to speak on Whispering Pines, the Keniston Saga. That'll be interesting. So we encourage you to sign up as a Historical Society member to support our efforts and receive notices of our programs and so on. There's also a listing that Lisa put together, updated, of all the upcoming programs on the table there. And we hope to circulate that sign-in book. Right after you sign that, young lady, just pass it around. We'll make sure everybody gets the chance to sign in. It's the one on the table next to the jar that says, donations.
That's the jar,
right? Hopefully you've had a chance to visit our exhibits here before. We continue to be open Saturdays, 10 to 2. We hope that you will stop by. One of our ongoing efforts is identification of Plymouth farms. And we encourage you to help with that effort, and I'll describe a few of those in a minute. As advertised, the program is free, although any donation you might make, even a dollar that I mentioned, is greatly appreciated, as we have many needs to improve the museum for public display, etc. Did I mention that the donation jar daily entrance, yeah, good. Oh, and also check out our table on the front here. We offer a number of fascinating books on Plymouth history, commemorative ornaments, and other items for sale. We will offer refreshments at the end of the program. And also be aware, we have to point this out, that there is an emergency rear exit through the kitchen. We also have a bathroom there as well. It's a one-holer. First come, first served, and BYORM, bring your own reading material. Let's start again talking about the ag history, a little bit of history of Plymouth. First settlement, of course, 1763. And you can imagine the folks that showed up from Hollis and southern New Hampshire towns and so on were busy clearing their lots. and building their rustic homesteads and building fences, removing stumps, and plowing the first field for their crops. And because they also had, it wasn't uncommon for them to have large families to help with the myriad of farm chores and care for the livestock. And some of the first farms were located on the terraces above the fertile floodplains of the Baker and the Pemigewasset rivers, often near streams that fed into these rivers for water supply for man and beast. One of Plymouth's earliest settlers built a modest farmstead on Fairgrounds Road, where I live, by what I call Glover's Brook or Calvin Clark Brook. Actually, it's this one here. I don't know if you've ever seen a picture of the old farmstead here. It's right by Fairgrounds Road. As you can go by, there's an old excavation. In fact, this was a little archaeological dig that they did. When was that, Betty? Probably 15 years ago or more. Yeah, time goes by. That they did an interesting excavation on that original settlement site. The David Hobart Farm, again, is on the property owned by Bill and Betty. These intrepid settlers farmed the rich floodplain soils and terraces. But we have to not forget that farm settlement in Plymouth and other area towns also occurred on the uplands, the hillsides. And it was always a surprise to me. Why farm on the thin and rocky soils on the hillsides? You know, why would somebody move up from southern New Hampshire and decide to do that? Any ideas why they might pick a...
Land was cheap.
Land was cheap, yeah. One,
Native two. Americans?
Indians, yeah.
Oh, safer, you mean, from yep. Natives? Possibly. Any other thoughts? Why would they start with... Yes.
Lowlands would get the frost.
Exactly. That was the main reason. The frost, they had about 2 weeks at least longer frost-free growing season, and that made a difference, you know, for these early settlements. Of course, they also had probably closer to the wood supply for feeding the wood stove for cooking, heating, and so on. So that early time period is just a fascinating period. In fact, I'm going to pass around. This is from the Warner Historical Society. It's got some fascinating photos of what early farm life was like, not just in Warner, just down the road, but certainly around here. It gives you some context of what we're talking about tonight. There are numerous old cellar holes, as you can imagine, up on Pike Hill Road, Old Hebron Road, Texas Hill Road, and of course, some of these farms didn't last for too many generations before the soil wore out. And then they moved on, obviously, in many cases, downhill where the soils were better and the farming was easier. But it is fascinating to look at some of the aerial photos of Plymouth that show from the early settlement days. When Plymouth was originally settled, for example, a lot of the original farms were laid out along the Baker River and along the lower interval here on the Pemi River. And it's interesting over time, if you look at an aerial photo, here's one, you can look at this later, 1955, you see a lot of open farmland and tillable acreage and so on. And just a few years later, we're down to 1970 to even a reduction in farms. And that's what we're seeing, obviously, over time, as farming doesn't cut it. And the development just changes, shifts from a farming mindset to other means of surviving. Crop fields are converted to woodland. Let's also keep in mind that the early settlers were also, by necessity, millwrights, sawyers, wheelwrights, merchants, woodchoppers, smithies, dairymen. They kind of had to do it all. They had no mechanized equipment to till the earth, just oxen to pull moldboard, plows, and cultivators. And essentially, they were subsistence farmers. They maybe had a few pigs and cows, chickens, maybe sold a few eggs off the farm to village residents. No veterinarians to rely on to help with the animals needed attention. No phones to call the neighbors for help. But some did prosper, and they expanded their farms by often acquiring additional land, better land. And they learned to diversify, to make a go of it. And the best part, they got to work their farms 24/7 with few breaks. You know, what a deal. John and Carol can relate, I'm sure, to that. How many of you know or of other Plymouth farms that have prospered over these years and survived as well as Longview Farm has. Not many. How many of you remember Hatch Dairy? Okay, we now have a paved parking lot over most of that. Was the Bonnie Brave Deer Farm? What was that called before Henry Ahern developed that? You know, was it just a dairy farm or what? I'm not sure I know. And many of us drive by the Marlin Farm on Tenny Mountain Highway every day. And you've got to wonder how many people that drive by it recognize for what it is back when it was in so-called heyday, or what happened to it, why did it go out of existence and so on. But instead of me droning on, let's hear how it really was to care for an expanded farm operation in today's economy. It gives me great pleasure to introduce tonight's speakers, Carol and John Perkins, a well-known and beloved Plymouth residents, who have carried on the long-standing agricultural traditions in their management of Longview Farm in West Plymouth. So without further ado, it's all yours.
Everyone here is a friend from a long time ago or recently or whatever. I see just so many familiar faces. It's awesome. That's what my son said when I said I was nervous. He said, "Oh, Mom, they're going to be a friendly crowd because." So I would first like to thank the Plymouth Historical Society for inviting us to be part of this event. And the picture that is on the screen right now was taken by Wes Levin, who took the picture of the stand. And some of you may know the gentleman that's standing in the picture. I don't know if they're here.
Hard to see.
See this gentleman? Does anybody know who that is? It's Dean Sherman. I'm sure many of you know Dean Sherman and Meredith. And they were coming to the stand this summer with boxes, flat cardboard flaps that we could use for putting our vegetables on for sale. And he just happened to be in the picture. So I posted that on Facebook, and his daughter said, "Wow, that's my dad!" I figured he's been around for quite a while. Before 1976, the Plymouth Record had features "Busy Dairymen of the Plymouth Region" by H.I. Redmond. And there were at least 12 active farms in that area that were in the articles. Not sure today how many remain. Some have diversified and expanded, and some have ceased to exist. But many farms are passed on to the next generation, like Walker Farm in Alexandria is a good example of that. There are many sons, and they're all going to continue the farm. Unfortunately, all our children got an education, and they all went off to do their own thing. So. In 1972, though, the farms that were listed were the Roby Farm in Bristol, Westloo Farm in Alexandria, which was Wesley Platt's, Caverhill Farm in Warren, Walker Farm in Alexandria, Benton Farm in Thornton, which he's expanded into just pancakes and so forth, Downing Farm in Wentworth, Sandburn Farm in Rumney, Stickney Farm in Campton, the French Farm in Rumney, which we use a lot of their land now, so it's still being farmed, and then the Over Dairy in Ashland. So prior to the Barneys even being at our farm, in 1936, the Barney Dairy in Rumney, I don't know if anybody would remember that. Oh, good. Well, maybe they could tell me more than I even know about it. But I have a clipping that was in the record, Plymouth Record, from 1936 that was an invitation to their new milk plant, because I guess they were the largest distributor of milk in the state of New Hampshire at that time, using their own milk, which is something new I didn't know. And they completed their new dairy in 1936, and 60 cows produced 700 quarts daily. And then in 1944, fire destroyed the Barney Farm and everything that was there, as far as I know. I don't know I was just a year old then in New Jersey, so. But so they had this bad fire, and Joel and Ruth Barney were helping at his father's farm when that burned, and so they bought Longview Farm in 1945 in July, and from Helena and James Spaulding. And at that point, they had brought their cows and started their farm there. And then in 1950, Barney's farm had the fire. And I think there's a picture of that. That's when the Barneys bought the farm from the Spauldings. And that's the fire, what's written on the front page of the record. And it destroyed the barn, and then the 50 cows, I guess, were in a tent in the yard. I can't imagine, but they were housed in a tent until the new barn was constructed. And then Joel and their children, Carolyn was 10 at the time and James was 7, and their home was fine, but they had to build a whole new barn. And I think the next one has, that's the new barn that they built after the fire in 1950. I mean, it's hard to imagine if
the one that's still standing?
Seen or, no, none of the barns are still standing from the original.
Do they know what caused the fire?
I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. That might have been an article further, but I didn't see anything. The next one, now this is the back of a Merrimack, and the Merrimack farmers, and remember when we first moved here in Plymouth, Merrimack farmers was down at the railroad station down there, active, but evidently they had a lot of building supplies and so forth, and so they used, Joel Barney used Merrimack to help build his new barn. And that is... In a Plymouth Fair edition of the Merrimack Messenger, they listed Joel Barney's farm, R.S. Yetton Farm in Plymouth, Jasper Windsor in Rumney, David Dickerson in Bridgewater, who had 550 chickens, and Charles Hall in West Rumney, who was a dairyman and... Okay, I'm getting a nod, so. I don't know some of these people, so. John and I started, just as a little background, when we purchased the farm. We started with nothing when we got married in 1965. We had no money, and I worked, and we didn't have much, so we've done well. We lived in Watertown, Connecticut for several years, where John worked on Walnut Grove Farm, Watertown, Connecticut, and that was owned by his grandparents, Benjamin and Rosetta Lynn, and he worked for them for several years after high school and when we were first married. But when John was a child in Bradford, New Hampshire, he had a garden and he sold vegetables out by Route 103 between Warner and Bradford. And so that's where it started, I think. And he also got his grandfather's genes somewhere in the mix, because he is very much like his grandfather. And I, of course, was born in New Jersey, and I lived for 16 years, 15 miles from Philadelphia. So I was more of a city girl, I guess. When I was 16, my parents and I moved to Warner. And then John and I both graduated from Simons Free High School in Warner, which is no longer there. It's part of Kearsarge Regional, but it was there then. And then I attended Plymouth Teachers College in 1962-63. But I had no farming background at all. And John's grandmother tried to warn me a few times, but... Following the death of my father, we took a huge leap, and we moved back to New Hampshire with two small children and lived with my mother and began our adventure in farming. We purchased our first 36 cows from a herd in Candor, New York, which is a really tiny little town near Ithaca. And John had to rebuild the barn that we leased in Bradford, New Hampshire for 4 years. So then we go to March 10th. We looked at the farm in Plymouth, Longview Farm in Plymouth, in 1975, and we looked at it in March. And you know what it looked like in March? It didn't look that hot. We were like, yeah, maybe that's not where we want to go. And the next August, we came back again, and we looked. And it was green, and the river was beautiful, and there was a beach at the river, and the corn was growing, and it looked really good. So we said, hey, that's where we're going. So we headed up here, and so the next March, we signed with the Barneys and purchased the 77 acres and the buildings that were there at the time. And then in March of 1977, we purchased 19 acres of open field from Henry Trow, who was probably in his late 80s at that point. Yeah. And Henry was a farmer, and he wanted to see his land continue as a farm. So he really didn't want it developed. And we said we wanted to farm it, so everybody was happy. So we bought that piece on the corner of Fairgrounds Road and Quincy Road in the beginning. And then we purchased 21 acres that abuts our farm and from the Huzzies, who had a farm. I guess their house and barn were on the opposite side of the road, but we bought the side of the road near our farm. And then we purchased...
Carol, did you deal with local banks? Did you deal with local banks?
No.
No, never did.
No, we Farm credit.
Farm credit.
Our financial partner for all these years. Now they aren't anymore, but they were. And FHA too, right?
Yeah.
And we bought 32 acres from Dr. Archibald and Fortica Archibald and Smith Bridge piece, as you all know. And then Henry died in 1981, and so we purchased 37 plus acres, which John said now is 49, so I don't know how that worked, but Henry's estate. Oh, that's what we're being taxed for. And then we sold, there was a little piece on the Baker River that Bob Thompson had owned and given to his sister for camping or whatever, and it's full of poison ivy. So I think his niece was only too happy to sell that piece of land to us so that they didn't have to worry. They came once to camp and they got their camper stuck in the field, so it wasn't successful. And then we bought 21.85 acres from Piper, which that was part of Bob Thompson's farm. So now we own 220 acres in Plymouth and Rome.
Wow.
We have 50 acres of sweet corn and vegetables. The other fields are hay and field corn. We rent 200 acres in Plymouth and Romney for field corn, in addition to our 220. We have 150 full-grown milking cows and 140 heifers and calves. And our herd of Holstein dairy cows are milked twice a day, every day. The feed for the cows must be harvested when it is ready. I've heard this all my 50 years. The seasons of the farm require close attention and care. Milk produced is picked up every day and taken to the Concord Hood plant. It used to be Weeks Dairy, but now it's part of Hood. In addition to our fields, we now have 12 greenhouses, which hold over 4,500 tomato plants. Greenhouses are used for early crops like beet greens and lettuce and peas, and then were moved with tractors and planted with tomato plants. We've done that. I don't know that that's going to happen this year, but it has in the past. And then there are beautiful, colorful pick-your-own flowers on black plastic and raised rows. And we have 5 John Deere gators. And we figured 20 tractors, give or take. And I've heard That you can never have too many. So we have the aerial. Why don't you keep the aerial? Up on the top is Newfound Lake. Which I thought was interesting at the elevation. We had some people from Switzerland that flew into the airport several years ago, and they took lovely pictures from the air of the farm, and they gave them to us.
Where is the airport? Is that the strip right here?
This is the railroad. Yeah, but
just across the street here.
Yeah, right here.
Yeah.
And that's probably the hangar. It's blurry. Okay, so then we got to building and rebuilding barns and shop, and pretty much as John said, we rebuilt everything that was there.
What's a pole barn?
Replaced or.
It's an equipment shed.
Equipment shed. Yeah. Okay, next, there we go. In the 40 plus years that we've been here, we've rebuilt all the buildings and the new buildings and renovated our house, and most of the work was done by our crew. And I think you can see, I think Joel and John, that was just a picture of complete destruction. And the next one, and that was when we had cranes come in with our, to put up the, finish the building or whatever. That was just, I have so many pictures of construction and so forth that I couldn't scan them all, so.
I was going to ask you, that barn, was that in the process of going or coming?
That was going and then being rebuilt.
We had to do it. So the cows had to be in there all day, every day. It milked every day. So all of this construction, the cows were still in there. We had to move things around to, so we could work on this section and then that section. But this, the new barn that Barney's built after the fire, this is the demolition of that and the present barn that's there is being built.
So that was before and this is after, and that's now a calf section. That was our last construction at the farm. And it's all open inside, so they can clean it all really well. It's all cement floor, and then they put individual calf pens in there when we have a lot of calves. Right now, it's pretty empty. But.
Did you notice any decrease in the production of milk while the cows were in there?
No, not really. They got used to working there over their heads.
Okay, typical day on the farm. Basically, there is no typical day on the farm. But a common day starts with milking cows at 6:30 every day. It doesn't matter if it's a holiday or what. Someone cleans the barn, which is open housing, with a tractor, feeds and cares for calves and dry cows, milks the cows, and cleans the milking parlor. In the winter, the chores are done by about 10:30, and workers go home until chores start again at 4. And in the spring, summer and fall, the work days are long, from about 6:30 to 7:30 at night, and there's much work to be done, and we repair all our own equipment unless we really need help. But there's never a dull moment. We grow our own corn for silage and chop most of the hay for haylage. We have two plus trenches that are filled first with chopped hay and then chopped corn. And we do bale some hay, not much, but some. Our cows are fed a mixture of haylage, silage, and grain. Our grain representative creates our feed program based on the results from samples that we send to the Cargill laboratory for analysis. We have a liquid manure system, which includes a large lagoon. I wanted a swimming pool, but we got a lagoon. We pump the liquid manure into trucks to spread in the fields at least twice a year, if not more. And I'm sure you smell it. But we're also members of the Dairy Farmers of America. And they pick up our milk and take it to Hood and Concord. So who do we have? Maggie, and we had Maggie with a calf, and she was a worker, and then Sue and Jane were feeding calves with bottles, and that's how the first calves are, when they're really young, they get bottles of milk and colostrum at Hope in the beginning. And this was just a cute picture of a calf with a puppy. And then our grandson Jack is over there, and I think it's 2003. He's a freshman in high school. But he was really cute. Okay, so the produce business. Our standard, you can go to the next one. Oh no. Okay, well, wrong one.
Did I get
Let me start with the beginning of why we even get into this business. In 1977, our neighbor Bob Thompson, who operated a successful vegetable business, died suddenly. And our business began in 1980, when we planted 2 acres of sweet corn. And our children were 11, 9, and 6, and they helped sell the corn. When customers came, we ran out the door and waited on them. So there weren't too many people, but probably a few of you were there too. During the 80s, our stand moved several times, increasing in size. We'll go to the net. There we go. The size, we were in the front of the house when we were so young. And then we moved and our kids were young. Great. And then the next one shows, well, it's a little bit out of order here for my list, but that's when it was on the side of the house. And our daughter said that we put it there to trap them. They couldn't go very far. They had to stay there. I just heard that recently. And then the stand on the side of the house with the fall vegetables and pumpkins, which is nothing compared to what it is now, but the next one, oops, okay, stop there. During the 1980s, as I said, our stand moved and increased in size with every time it moved. And our help in the garden increased too. So we started, when we started as a small family operation, we grew and grew and grew. Our children grew, and each child was able to graduate from college from the college of their choice with no debt. UNH, Earlham, and Colby Sawyer. Around 2000, we added more workers and expanded our variety of vegetables. Peggy Grass began working with us, joining her husband Joel, who has been working in the dairy operation since high school. Our workers do field work, harvest vegetables, wash vegetables, prepare them for display on the stand. There is much prep work to be done each day. Once corn season starts, the crews start picking corn at 8 a.m. and then during the day as needed. Freshness is important to us and to our customers. I think we had a picture of Jeff at the...
Can we go back?
At the stand that we had over at Agway, probably many of you all remember that. But we were over at Agway when we had the fire that destroyed the Smith Bridge. We couldn't go, and people couldn't get to us as easily, so we tried to make it easier for them by being over there. And I think Jeff was probably in college. We need to... Okay, so we had the cucumbers and tomatoes, and I'll just tell you about it. They're not on the screen right now, but plants are started from seed, and they're plugs or they're then transplanted to bigger pots. And when they're planted outside, we usually have a Remake cover, and they're on black plastic. So we go back to strawberries. Do you want to go strawberries? Strawberry fields. Such a beautiful picture of Stinson, and it's coming, folks, and it will come. And then we had the strawberries, and I said, don't we wish that we could enjoy these beautiful, delicious, fresh strawberries right now?
I'm sure we would like to. This is a cornfield, and we didn't have those in 1976
when we came there. Sweet corn is always a highlight of our season. We hold a corn contest for customers each year, and they guess the correct first day of corn, and they win a whole dozen corn, but it's very competitive. They do wait. People are asking about it way in advance. So. And that's Kim on our reggae weeder, and that weeds next to the rows, and it's pulled by a tractor. We do hand weeding, plenty of that, I'm sure. Kate could attest to that, but this was a quicker way to get the little weeds on the sides. Flowers. We offer a variety of flowers. Cut your own flowers are popular in the summer. Many wedding parties come and cut their own flowers for their special event. And we planted over 2,000 glads every year, and then the other flowers are started from seed, and I think they'll still have flowers next year. So, and also honey was in that picture, and we have honey. We have beehives down in our field, and they're still down there from last year. I don't know if they're alive or not, but they're down there, the hives and the bees. And we sell the honey that is made from those bees, so it's very local. And that was just a picture of our stand in the fall with all the mum plants from another farm. We buy them, but they look so pretty in the yard. So. Lucy! This is our dog, Lucy. We have several John Deere gators, which are used by our workers every day. They don't like trucks anymore. They prefer a gator. And so the workers go to and from the fields in the gators, and there's sometimes a flat tire or whatever, so it's always a little tight to get that gator. But Lucy, our dog, loves the gator, and every night after everyone leaves, she gets on the gator and we go down to the river, and she gets to go for a swim, or she picks flowers with me out in the field. But she does love her gator. This is a picture from the farmers market in Camden, which is no longer in existence, but we are members of the Plymouth Farmers Market, and that is every Thursday in the summer from 3 to 6. And that was fall. So pretty. The decorations and nothing special, but just at the end of the season. Next one. Okay, we used our greenhouse for fall squash and pumpkins, and then we used the same greenhouse for the calves. Built the individual pens in there, and we didn't do that this year, but in previous years we have. And that was just pretty of the maple tree in the yard. Fall in New England. The next one. We were honored to be a favorite farm stand by the viewers of MUR for several years. And thanks to our customers who voted, because you all voted, or maybe didn't vote, but... and I might also note, we have the best, most generous customers ever. The last several years, we've had a container on the stand for the New Hampshire Food Bank. And this last year, we sent over $2,000 to the food bank from our stand. From our customers. It was not from us. It was from our customers. All of you. Thanks to the donations, we have fed many hungry folks in New Hampshire, and that was great, and it was so much more. I think the year before it was 1,000, so we doubled. Special events and open farm days. We've had several open barn and story time events. Our daughters and grandchildren helped whenever possible. Our two daughters are teachers in New Hampshire schools in Londonderry and Ware. And we participated for several years at the Pease Public Library Touch a Truck event at the Plymouth Airport, and where folks can come of all ages to check out transportation equipment of all kinds. But also, we helped feed hungry children during the summer as part of the Got Lunch Plymouth and the Got Lunch Romney program. Got Lunch Plymouth has been serving the Plymouth community for the last 5 years. Lunches are delivered every Monday to families who apply, and then they're given coupons that for farm fresh vegetables, and they come to the farm and pick up what they want and what they need in their household. And that goes through the whole summer. We also participated in the senior food program several years ago that helped seniors in Ashland and Plymouth. And we donate leftover vegetables or extra vegetables, and usually whatever corn is left, to Meals for Many. And the Warren Wentworth Food Pantry picks up things on Friday morning, early. That is Kate and Elizabeth, and at our open farm event in 2015 with a cat. And Becca and Sarah being very creative at the wash stations. We actually paid them to do that, I guess. And these are our grandchildren, Kat and Dan Jepson, and they helped scoop ice cream at the open farm event in July of 2015. It was lots of fun. And we thank the Granite State Dairy Promotion, who brought the ice cream for everybody and milk that they shared. And Maggie and Emily were our workers, and they're standing in front of many vehicles or tractors and gators or whatever for people to check out at our open farm day. Aha, Longview Farm celebrates Plymouth's 250th celebration. And that was our float going down Main Street, our granddaughter and son-in-law. And then I, is that John Perkins driving John Deere tractor on Main Street in Plymouth? It happened once, and probably that's the only time. So I hope you saw that. Because he usually is in the field, not out on Main Street. And that is kind of the barren fields. After a busy, successful season, time to rest. And then the next one is a view from the air, aerial view from the airport. And there's actually another picture over here that, what are the things, the little noisy things that are up in the air, you know? Little guys. Oh, one of the flyers gave us that picture that's over here. From that he took the picture from there. And there's several other pictures and milk bottles and a couple other old pictures and also calendars that I made from 2007. And they're not every year, but there's seven of them over here. So look at them, because there are lots of people that you know probably. You might even be in the picture when you didn't know it. As we look forward to some rest and reorganizing our life, we are happy that two young folks look forward to owning Longview Farm produce business. Nate Everts and Regina Rinaldo are leasing the vegetable business with hopes of buying the farm from us in the near future. Nate and Regina are here tonight. And they worked for us full time last year, learning our process and our daily operations, which I'm sure will change, but
But we're moving forward.
They're busy right now fixing greenhouses and starting tomato plants. And we hope that everyone will support a local couple as they begin a new adventure on our farm. And I guess that's it, except that I have an awesome poem that our worker, Mrs. Donahue, has agreed to read, because she's the poet laureate of Plymouth, aren't you? But it's a poem about waiting for corn at Longview that was written by Liz All.
Okay, why don't you
say
it
right up front? I took a sprung along there in the last minute. So I could read it, but I think she would probably read it better than I would.
Do I get a free dozen corn for this? Waiting for Corn at Longview Farm by Liz All. Monday after work, 1st of August, the sweet corn just started selling Saturday, and today, sold out. Just before I pulled into the gravel driveway, a man in an idling silver Jaguar, Massachusetts plates, eyes me, asserts his place in the invisible line with a look. It's like he's planted a lawn chair in his shoveled out parking space. Others arrive, see us waiting, and wordlessly join the queue. The cat stalks flies on the empty expanse of formica where the corn should be. We're hungry for it, and we've been waiting longer than these 15 minutes. Since March, we've imagined the first tender ears, pale kernels, sweet bite, and juice. And when it looked like mud season was done, it rained through most of May and June. I drove past fields, slowing down, pining, drawn as if to the neighborhood of someone who broke my heart. When the pickup rumbles from the field and finally backs up to the stand, we straighten up, crane our necks to see what's just been picked for us. We start calling numbers. 6, 12, 18, and the women, always women, behind the counter start bagging. This produce is the last labor piled between them and their dinner. It's what we held up for dinner, too. Each golden kernel, the clean silk, pale green inner leaves. 1 minute in the boiling pot, the shine of butter, spray of pepper, fresh burst of everything worth waiting for. Yep.
Over a little bit of the farm, and I realized that 41 years is, you know, you can't put all that into a short program. But if anybody has a question, we're John is here.
Years ago, I remember meeting Joel Barney, but I never got to know him. Could you tell us more about him?
I don't know that much about him, really. I mean, but I had his dates and that kind of thing, but we just bought the farm from him, and so I don't know.
Okay.
He was 87 when he died, and all the other people that were here.
My name is Steve Davis, a farmer, formerly of Rummy. My family is dear friends of Joel and Ruth. A couple interesting facts. The creamery on Fairgrounds Road, my dad worked out of that to move milk to Rumney, Plymouth, Plymouth, Winchester. I went around with him when I was about 4 years old, 54. But talking about the farm, Ruth and Joel were members of Rumney Baptist Church, my family, a part of church family. But one of the interesting facts, anybody remember Les Coffin, Lester Coffin.
Yeah.
Okay. When Joel's barn burned and they rebuilt it in 42, Lester Coffin was a very talented inventor. He invented the very first
barn cleaning
system, you know, the takes them north up. Very first one in the nation. It was put into that new barn. Joel contracted it to be done. Later, Lester went on to the World's Fair and had it developed a continuously operated manure dump truck. Lester was very talented. Joel recognized that. But he was a terrible businessman. FMC got all his patents. He never did a patent on either of them. So just my two cents.
So he also was Charlie's father, right?
Yeah, excuse me?
Okay, Charlie's father.
Yeah.
I know Charlie.
Okay. Yeah, Charlie and Vicky. Another thing interesting in my family tie to this firm is that my wife, Paula King, great aunt, Spalding, sold it to Barney.
Cool. Right. And I know Sue Evans was her grandparents that were the Spaldings, correct?
Okay.
Yeah, because she gave me a couple of older pictures, and she had lived there, I believe, with her grandparents for a little bit, or at least visited. Mm-hmm. So she had a total connection with
her. Yeah, she wanted to make sure she came tonight to hear the history and your stories.
Well, I don't...
We're tied into
I don't know the whole history.
I understand the bodies were quite religious, that they read the Bible every morning, they started the day off.
Well, they had, Joel had four brothers with it. They all went into the ministry except Joel. He was the only one who stayed farming.
Well, he needed the Bible to go into farming. He needed religion.
Then his son went to UNH for dairy management and so forth. And Joel built a new milking parlor, spent quite a lot of money on the old barn. And then Jim worked for him for a little while and then decided he wanted to be a minister too. So that was when Joel kind of was up for sale.
Excuse me, John, would you be willing to stand up and speak a little louder? Thank you.
I met Joel Barney early. I'm one of the founding members of the Plymouth was a Coal Society, and he was one of the members there. And I remember I talked to him quite a bit because I grew up in a very, very small town, a farm village, and my best friend was a farmer's daughter, and I always wanted to marry a farmer. Didn't happen, but I talked to him many times, and I remember when he was ready to sell, he could have sold that land for a fortune, but he said, no, it's got to be a farm. I want somebody who's a farmer there, and I was just so happy, you know, when we started farming there. So.
Another question over here? Go ahead. That's you.
kind of a piece of interesting, hilarious situation. Eleanor's father here, this has got to be 55, 60 years ago. And Eleanor, do you remember Rosie the Holstein?
Oh, yes.
Her father says, I'll give you $5 to go in to milk Rosie. I said, okay, give me the bucket. I walked in. I was there about 3 seconds. I came out 3 feet off the ground horizontally. Her father thought that was hilarious. And I didn't get my $5. And old Rosie still had horns.
Other questions?
We had one cow that would stand beside the fence and watch as we were going off to town and stand right there and not move until the cow was out of sight. This is what our next door neighbor told us. The minute the cow was out of sight, whoosh, over the fence.
We haven't had many escapes in our 40s, whatever years. A few, most recently we had a few heifers that were in the lower barn that decided that they wanted to get out. They broke their plates and they came up, and John and I were alone, and I'm like, we're definitely too old for this. I'm on a gator out on the street because they went out to Quincy Road, onto the road, three of them, and I'm like, okay, I'm herding them around. But we got them in. We got them in the barn. But it was easier when there were more people around to help.
Any other comments or questions? Yes.
Just one other one. Your focus seems to be on the dairy cattle. Were you ever sidetracked by other animals? You decided to go and explore goats or sheep or llamas? No? Always cows.
Just cows. That was what I always... I never intended to get into the produce business. But when people started showing up to my little 2 acres of corn there, and that was the start, so and then we took off from there.
What are you going to do now?
I'm going to milk cows
for a while. He's still milking cows for a while.
Yeah, but what about the after a while?
Well, I don't know.
We can't get there yet.
Baby
we're working
steps.
On it, but that's in the future, I guess. In our
so I have an idea. Do you know the farming game, John?
We have one of those, yeah.
Our kids started on that game.
Well, we have a farming game that's a board game that's before the farming game that's on.
Other comments out back? Questions?
No, that's the one I'm talking about.
I remember the creamery on Fairgrounds Road.
Yeah.
Way back.
It's now what? Pemmy Commons? I think is
yes,
the development.
That's where it
was. Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I think the reason, this is my, after doing this, I figured that the Barneys had a dairy and an operation like that when they were at his father's, and that was probably why when they came there, Mr. Thompson was doing vegetables. They wouldn't have thought of, you know, going into any other thing, and so they started. I know people here, I'm sure, had milk delivery for years with Joel Barney, because he had the processing plant on Fairgrounds.
Could you comment on the weather patterns and issues that you had with storms? And what's being?
I'll tell you, the first year we bought the farm, we were going into all that debt. We had no down payment. All we had was 100 head of cattle, and then we used the equity there. But in May, I was planting corn down on the lower end of the other end of the airport, and the ground was dry. And I said, "Oh my God, what did I do?" And I said, "This corn's never gonna make it." And I went back, and she was down at the river with the kids, and I went down, and I was discouraged. And she had a picnic lunch, and I went back and finished planting that, and I couldn't believe it. In 3 or 4 days, I went back down to see if the corn had even sprouted, and it was up already. Boy, I was in.
That's a sandy soil we weren't used to.
It's a sandy soil we weren't used to. We were used to a wet soil. And the rain just seems to come there. I buy crop insurance for the corn. And I don't know why, because they always get the rain at the right time.
That's great.
The hay crop gets a
Well, we've had a flood too. When Irene came, we had a flood in many of our fields, which we'd never ever seen before. Came right in.
There was sweet corn that year we couldn't pick. The university said, don't pick anything that was underwater. Mm-hmm. And the stalks were, you could see right where the water was, because it was completely muddy stalks. Mm-hmm. And then, so any of the years that were above the mud, we picked.
Question?
They just answered.
Okay. Other questions or comments? Anybody? Wow, this is great. We appreciate the turnout here. I'd like to take an opportunity to thank John and Carol. Thank you. years, 20 decades in Plymouth, and another little small donation to the cause.